Everyone, it's Ross, and today I want to give you guys a little bit of a tour of the backyard. It's the spring. We did a tour actually not too long ago, but I didn't like how it came out, so we're doing it again. Maybe some of you guys saw that video, we even published it. But you know, everything's actually a bit further along. Everything's like really either flowering or leafing out, and I think it's a bit more interesting anyway. So I think there's a lot more to see now. So let's do the tour. I do want to mention that I feel like we need a name for this backyard. We need a name for our orchard, and I can't really come up with a name. I'm horrible at coming up with names. So maybe you guys have a name for this, but or an idea for a name. I'd love to hear it. I want to show you guys how everything's really progressing back in here. You can see it's really gorgeous looking, and we've tried really hard actually to make this really beautiful as well as productive. That's really the name of the game, and you can see our production comes in, and it's also really beautiful. I mean, rows of apples. We have a nice, really long, thick log coming in the middle here. I think it's really beautiful what a backyard orchardist can accomplish. So, but you can see there's about 20 varieties back here of apple trees. These are on dwarf rootstock. They're gonna get reasonably tall, but they don't really get too wide, I've noticed. And I'm not gonna, I think, prune them really all that much this year. I'll probably wait to prune them, not this winter, but the next winter. Because I really kind of want them to go nuts here. And the form is not bad, right? We've also got them kind of growing in the right direction, right? I just stake them up. Like this guy here is a little bit off to the left too much, but these trees on this side are going to grow out this way. And then these trees in this row are going to grow out this way. And it's the same thing down here. That's what we're trying to really focus on. We've also really focused on this year setting up some new things that we've talked about, is that this is a kiwi vine that we planted here called Anna. Yes, you can grow kiwi in Pennsylvania. In fact, it's very common in Pennsylvania. There's a couple orchards. And, you know, it's going to grow along this wire that we've set up. And I may want to lower the wire, set up a second wire, maybe even, you know, really upgrade this whole pole and get myself more of a tiered system at the top here. But I think this should mostly do for now. And essentially this is really already at the wire and going to come across the wire to the left and to the right. And then what we'll have is a nice little arch that these new branches are going to come out like this, and the other branches are going to come out like this. And it'll create a really nice umbrella effect. And what we've got behind me is two new plum trees. There's a plum there and a plum there. Both of these guys are going to be a spyade along the wires here. And you can kind of get them out as I move closer. So we'll have a set of branches, one going out this way. So this branch will be tied down to here at the end of the season. This branch will get tied down to here. And then new branches that are forming right now will get tied down to this one and to this one. And that will be the permanent structure of this plum. And believe it or not, it's going to look beautiful. Because, let me show you guys my other spyade stone fruit. Remember these guys? They're huge now. These are my peaches that are spyade. They're easily 15 feet. Actually too big. But we have them in a three-tier system, so some branches here, here, and down here. And what we're doing with this is just really focusing on one beauty, but getting a lot of production. You can see that they're very, very productive. Look how beautiful, and look how many flowers there are in one branch. It's just insane. I would say though, from about here to the end of that branch, we're only gonna be able to really have about one or two fruits. So even though there's all these beautiful flowers, and it may seem like this tree is insanely productive, we can't keep all those fruits. I'm expecting somewhere in the neighborhood of about maybe 200 fruits a piece. That would be ideal, but we'll see what happens, because I am expecting a frost. Today's only April 11th, and I am expecting a frost to come in here and really hit a lot of these flowers that I'm gonna show you guys around the property today. So a bit disappointing, but we don't know if it is gonna happen, but I do expect, I'd say there's probably about a 50% shot at this point of the year, because we still have about 3 weeks of potential frost between now and May 1st, or maybe even a little bit after that. The temperatures have been really warm here. I guess a nice little backstory to give you guys is that it's been super warm. Today is not really that warm, but the ground has not been frozen since about early March. And we've had just crazy temperatures in the last 2 weeks. Last weekend, it was about 75, even close to 80 degrees here, which is insane. So yeah, it's been a challenge. And I'm wondering, because now all the apples are waking up, all my plums have certainly woken up. We'll show you guys them on the other side of the yard, but you can see more of them here. Even this young plum has put on some flowers. And you know, these guys, if the frost comes in and hits these flowers, say goodbye to the fruit for that year. So I'm really crossing my fingers and trying to hope that these apples and everything really gets protected. You can see a lot of flowers are opening up on this branch of this tree, and all the apples really in the next, I would expect the next 2 weeks to have full blossoms. Now you can see here some on the tip of this variety, all these little individual flowers. Wish the camera would focus, but pretty cool. It's really interesting how these flowers form too. And there's like these little individual flowers that start out maybe as one or two buds, and then they turn into about a cluster of five or six. We did just plant, maybe you saw that video, we did just plant some muscadine grapes back in here. So this whole area has really transformed. I wish I had like a picture of this whole area. There's a lot going on in this little corner of the yard. I'm shocked and really loving it, because it looks so beautiful, and it's gonna look even better when everything's really fully grown and everything's really leafed out. But you can kind of get the idea, is that all along the fence is a wire of something. We've got the European grapes, which are also leafing out right now. Along the back wire behind the apple trees is also going to be more grapes of the muscadines. We have the rows of apples, a nice little garden bed in here. We put in some yacone in here and potatoes. The honey berries are flowering underneath the grapevines. I'll show you guys that in a second. And then on this side, we have the espaliered plums and this nice kiwi vine that's going to create a nice little umbrella shape in this little area. So overall, I'm just really impressed, and can't wait to see the beauty of this whole area. We've even got things down in here that are a bit interesting. I may have to move them, I would expect, because this kiwi vine can be a bit troublesome. But look at the kiwi vine already at the top wire. And look at these leaves, they're so pristine looking, so interesting looking. And they're just gonna go along this wire, that's really all it is. But this is a gooseberry down in here. And this guy has wicked thorns, man. But this is what I would describe as, for a backyard orchardist, if you like grapes, you should be growing a gooseberry. Because gooseberries are about a month or so earlier than a European grape. And you'll have a nice little harvest window that way, by getting the gooseberry first. And then once the gooseberries finish, you'll have the European grapes back along the fence. And then once that's done, you'll have the fall grape, AKA the muscadine grape, come in. And you'll pretty much have grapes from all the way from July, early July, to the end of the year. Really cool. These little guys here, soon to be very big, actually. Not going to be very little for too long, but this is a gummy berry. Very strange fruit. It may not even really taste that great. We're going to have to find out, but this is supposed to be one of the earliest fruits. It is one of the earliest fruits. So I personally think you can't beat a strawberry, but these things are already flowering. You can kind of make this out in here. Let me see if I can get this to focus for you guys. This is a bit of a challenge. You can kind of see it down here. This is a better view, I think, right here. I don't want to break anything as I bend down, but you can see them kind of hanging from the bottom here. See that? And then this is the new branch coming out. Okay, you guys can see that perfectly now. So this thing should be covered in flowers, which is really cool to see. We have two varieties, I think, Carmine, and I think the other one's like Red Gem, something like that. And I got to taste some last year. Well, actually, I got to ripen some last year, but the birds got to them. So all these red early fruits really are tough to protect from the birds. The honeyberries are kind of really going to be a challenge. For those of you who don't know what a honeyberry is, this little guy here will eventually be about 6 feet by 6 feet if I let it. And you can see them over here. They're a bit more mature. I'm expecting this particular plant here, you can see all those yellow flowers in contrast to the green, is that I'm expecting this guy to be about 4 feet by 4 feet at the end of the year, which is going to be insane. But yeah, it should go nuts. And I should have lots of honeyberries next year. This one's a bit worrying because even though I have like late flowering honeyberry varieties, which is something you really have to pay attention to, in this climate, you can see they're flowering right now. So this one actually hasn't put out too many flowers at all. And it's actually a bit later than the other two varieties. The one here to my right is a bit further advanced than actually this one. Which is weird because I think this one has the most leaves ahead of the game. So it's kind of like a weird little contrast here. And that this one's put out a lot of leaves before it has even thought about flowering. But then again, maybe it's because this one doesn't have many flowers on it. I don't know. What we need to do, actually, I don't know what this is. This looks like a, what is this? Is this a praying mantis cocoon? What is this? Does anyone know what this is? That's so cool. What a weird looking thing. I don't want to disturb this if this is indeed a praying mantis cocoon. I love those guys. They're definitely all over too. What we have in here actually is potatoes, and they're taking a bit to put out their leaves, but you can see they're actually now finally forming. What I need to do is put this guy back in here, cover him up with some more straw. He got exposed. We may have to get more straw, actually, and cover them up even further than we have. But you can see all over this little area, underneath the grapevines, underneath all the trees, are going to be just, it's just tons of food. Here's a sugar snap peas that we transplanted. We're going to be growing, in this little section here, we're going to be growing soybeans again. I've done it. This is my third year in a row underneath the grapevines here. And that's really good for edamame. And here we have actually a nice little rosemary plant that I think is dead. So a bit of a shame, but it does appear to be green in here. So I don't know. This may be the first year that this has actually survived for me. And I bet you if I dig down in here, break down something lower, this should be alive. Okay, that doesn't look alive. But maybe this is. Yeah, that looks alive. So I think I'm actually going to have a perennial rosemary plant this year for the first time ever. This is a variety called ARP. A-R-P. It actually smells great, and I bet you I could still use this as food, but I don't know. It smells wonderful, man. What also smells wonderful is right next to it, and this is kind of a bit invasive. If you let it get invasive, this is my mint. This is my chocolate mint. And this stuff's gorgeous. I love it. You know what? It may take over a little bit, but this is now kind of the time of the year you got to come in here. And if it's kind of growing out in the direction you don't want, like this one, just dig up this little shoot here and bring it back. And if the soil's wet, you do this on a wet day, you got much better chances here. But let me take some off and eat it, because this stuff's like a really good mint. It's a natural mint, like breath mint. Anyway, you can see down underneath the apples, we planted lots of strawberries. We moved them from the other bed. We've got more June bearers coming in. And these June bearers essentially are going to populate this little area, and we'll spread them out. One variety here, this is going to be Early Glow, and then Rucker Scarlet in this section here, divided by this nice log. And in between, along the log, I have turmeric and ginger. And all this stuff's going to be perennialized here. Pretty insane. But really, really nice, because I love strawberries, especially in this climate. We've also got things like alpines. The alpines are going to be mostly my main focus here. We're propagating a lot in the house right now. They don't seem to really be doing well. They take a long time. They're little seeds. One of the most difficult things to propagate. But we are taking them very seriously. We've also got things down in here like flower bulbs. And you can see, here comes the flowers now. These guys are gorgeous, man. I planted them all over the property, various types of them. I picked them up late in the season last year from Burpee or various places. You can kind of get these really discounted, like super late in the season when nobody's thinking about growing anything anymore. These things go on sale, and I picked up like probably about 80 or so bulbs for like maybe 10 bucks. You can see here's more of them, different types. Look how beautiful that is. This is all over the house, even in the front. Really making this area beautiful is the name of the game. Right underneath the gummy berry. Gummy berries, by the way, are nitrogen fixing. So they're really help feeding this hugelkultur bed that they're in. We used to have a really big compost pile back in here. We took all that material out and just put it over here, and because it just wasn't composting. And we've just built up the soil by an incredible amount. You can see the comfrey is coming back. In fact, I think the comfrey is putting out flowers, or putting out all these seeds from last year. They're all coming up. These will turn into a million comfrey plants if I let them. But if they get to some decent size, we'll come in here and weed them all out. It's not a big deal. It's a pretty small area. But really, really cool, and I'm trying to get more strawberries to come up in this bed, because I would like a nice little understory, not just these, you know, these nice little hedgy type bushes underneath this kiwi vine, but also strawberries as a nice little ground cover. We're gonna put a lot of these alpines, by the way, they are coming back, but we're gonna put a lot of them on the other side of the house. I'll show you guys in a minute. There's so much to see over here, it's crazy. I've been in one area for about 20 minutes now. But we also have in here, these are the pawpaws, and the pawpaw are indeed swelling. They are indeed leafing out. I would say very shortly we will have some pawpaw leaves to look at, and I really hope that this is the year. We've got lots of organic fertilizer on these pawpaw trees. the roots are actually quite shallow, and I've been inspecting them. Look at how like many dense roots there are. Very small roots. You can see the organic fertilizer here and here. We've been feeding this area for years. The soil profile probably in this section is insane. So I'm just, you know, I'm kind of begging the pawpaw gods right now, please grow. Please flower, please turn into large trees, because I'm getting old, you know. Plus I'm not going to be on this property for forever, so I'd like them to flower while I'm still here, and then that way I probably can't dig them up. They don't transplant very well, but I could certainly at least get a better idea of how they grow and get a better opinion of them. I love the fruit, but you know, it's a bit of a shame, especially if they don't flower in the next 2 or 3 years. Here we have a kiwi vine. This is a male kiwi vine, so you need a male and a female. Not a big deal, but without the male, you need to have a nice little trellis for it. Without the male, you're not going to get any fruit. So it's definitely something you need, and I've tried the variety Asai, and Asai is supposed to have male and female flowers, and for me, it's just a weak kiwi vine. But here, this thing is going to go nuts, and it's going to go too nuts, I think. But I'm expecting it this year. I'll probably hopefully attach it to this tree, and that's the goal. And once it attaches to this tree, this will be a living trellis for the kiwi vine. Behind, actually, this big shade tree, we have all kinds of sedum. You can see there's sedum down in here. We've had the sedum here for years. And then we also have, I don't know what these are, I forget, but these things come back every year without fail. And it fills up this whole area with them. Very easy to propagate, very easy to spread around. You can see back in here, to my buddy Steve, if he's watching, this is the Saskatoons that you gave me. There's one of them. He's leafing out right now. And I expect this guy to get some size. We're also gonna open this area up a little bit with the light. That was a big issue last year, is I wanna cut out these couple branches right here that are gonna bring in some light by getting rid of this to this area where I'm standing right now. We have another Saskatoon somewhere in here. I've noticed this thing, which I don't know what this is. Maybe I planted this, maybe I didn't. Oh, look at this. This is a branch of, oh, this is a root, it looks like. Oh no, this is not a root. This is a branch of something we had put here to compost, and it's now leafing out. That's crazy. This stuff just doesn't want to die, I swear. It's really hard to kill something in this climate. I don't have to water one little bit. But where is the other Saskatoon in here? Ah, this looks like him right here. Oh my god, he got chopped back big time by something. But he's leafing out. You can see that right there. Huh. May have to protect that guy next year. But we also have another honeyberry here. This is the one that I am kind of really have high hopes for. This is a Boreal Beauty or Boreal Beast. These two are much sweeter, later flowering. You can see the flowers are not as progressed. So that's nice to see. And it should be a tastier variety. We have lots of weeds coming in here. We're gonna have to eventually come in here and weed this out. This is a nice little Hugel culture bed that we created last year. You can see this whole thing is really filled with branches and logs of that size. Topped it all off with some rice holes, topped it off with some excess soil from the compost pile. Here we have a nice little goji berry, and I'm really just having these here for aesthetics. I'm not a big fan of the fruit, but if they go nuts, I'll come out here one day and pick them all on that day and dry them and add some sugar to them, and they're actually going to be a tasty little treat that way. Otherwise, not a big fan. I may even take them out, so we'll see what happens with them. We've got more flower bulbs down in here. And then back actually over here is a josta berry related to the currant and the gooseberry. And then here's our nice huge pile of mulch that we are breaking this down. We need to come in here this weekend. We're going to break all this up. It's too big, too large, too many large pieces. Break this down into smaller sizes and really focus on getting this to all of it, have it touch the ground, and that's going to help it really break down. All this is going to break down over time, maybe about 3 years from now we're looking at, and it's going to add a lot of fertility to this area. And historically, you can kind of tell by the grass, it just doesn't grow very well back here. There isn't too much light. This whole area is just horrible soil. Really, this whole area, we've amended this, and if we didn't amend it, nothing would grow. So this area is the same thing. We need to really add some fertility. You can see my really nice form on this American persimmon, and that he's actually leafing out, which is crazy. Because if you think about it, persimmons are one of the last things to wake up. We even have some nice mulch in the soil. But because these things are really, it's been so warm here, it just doesn't seem to really matter. Everything's waking up, and we'll see, we'll show you guys that. As I said, today's only March 11th, or April 11th, I'm sorry. What a mess. So I guess that kind of concludes this little area here. 27 minutes in, we got to one area. It really is just too much to see, guys. I don't know how else to do this, but here's the peaches. Did we show you guys the peaches yet? But they are incredibly beautiful. And underneath, because we like to grow everything so close, you guys noticed, I'm sure, everything's so close. We even got all different types of crops underneath these peaches. We have strawberries. That's Rucker's Scarlet there. Here's the Egyptian walking onions. We've got bee balm right there, as well as some chives mixed in with the bee balm. Here's a whole bunch of shallots. These are from Brian in Louisiana. And we have another set of shallots behind it. We planted these in the fall. These come from some nursery. You can see those guys are going nuts. And there's even more alliums in the form of leeks that we've overwintered here all winter. We planted them out actually a year ago today, which is kind of nuts. So hopefully they get some size this year. It took them a while to get going. But you can see these are actually peas that we had transplanted out as well. Started these indoors. Some of them already have flowers. But these peaches, man, really, really productive. Very excited. They're also very healthy trees, man. And someone did point out this little oozingness here, but this really just indicates a nice little wound on the tree. This is not really an issue that I have to really worry about, at least I don't think. So it doesn't look very diseased to me, and if it continually oozes, then that's a problem. But it seems like this is just one little spot on the tree that is having some sort of issue, and it just is what it is. So we'll keep an eye on it, but for the most part, I've been pretty impressed with these peaches, man. Man, been impressed. I've always liked to check behind the trees because they are against the fence and it's a different view, right? Different viewpoint. And if you don't kind of observe them from behind, it just, there could be something going on behind the tree, like oozing sap that you don't really know about. Maybe some disease or something. I'm gonna put this over the top of the fence. These flowers, man, are just beautiful. We have peaches actually in the front that are in the ground too, and they've been blooming, but the flowers look very different. And it's amazing how each variety even has different flowers. Hey guys, we kind of got cut out of there at some point, but I want to do just a nice little thank you for all you guys who've been watching, got through this entire tour and still are watching. I really appreciate it. Follow me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, because you guys are the biggest fans, and I feel like you guys would like to hear it and would like to see that kind of stuff the most. So yeah, hope to see you guys there. Check out the new website as well, rossratty.wixsite.com/blog. All that's in the description. And yeah, I want to thank all of you guys who got to this point for watching. Really, I appreciate it. So take care, guys, and I'll see you for tomorrow's video. All right.